Good evening. Today's program we are going to start now, and this is a program on women in science and technology. You know that this is a series that has been initiated by the office of the principal scientific advisor to PM. So today it is actually a real pleasure for me to introduce a very remarkable person, Dr. Sudipta Sengupta, who's going to speak. So I'll briefly introduce her. She's an ardent mountaineer and a structural geologist. And she was one of the first Indian women to set foot in Antarctica. She did that as a part of third Indian scientific expedition to Antarctica, about which we are going to hear from her today, and this all the stories you're going to tell us, and was probably the best part of her career and maybe of her life. She visited Antarctica again for a second tryst with the Earth's southernmost continent. So her work there in a hill called Shirmashar Hills is of fundamental importance, because it became the basis of further research in that area. Now, talking about her education and appointments, she's an alumnus from the Jadavpur University at Kolkata, where she did her PhD as well. And in the early part of her career, she worked as a geologist in the Geological Survey of India. And following her short stint at this institute, Dr. Sengupta spent 3 years at the Imperial College in London for her postdoctoral studies. And she had a prestigious scholarship over there of the Royal Commission for the Exhibition of 1851 from UK. Subsequently, she joined the Institute of Geology of Uppsala University in Sweden, and thereafter a visiting scientist for the International Geodynamics Project, supervised by Professor Hans Romberg. On her return to India, Sudipta rejoined the Geological Survey as a senior geologist, and subsequently became a part of the Jadavpur University as a lecturer, from where she retired as a professor in 2011. To summarize her work in general in structural geology, I'm sure she's going to talk a little bit about it, that Professor Sengupta has combined geological field studies with laboratory experiments and theoretical analysis in the major part of her research. Apart from doing structural field studies in varied terrains, including peninsular India, the Scottish Highlands, the Scandinavian Caledonites, and East Antarctica, she was responsible for creating a number of experimental techniques while working in Jadavpur University, Imperial College, and the Uppsala University. Her accolades include the Bhatnagar Prize of CSIR, National Mineral Award of Department of Mines, Antarctic Award of Department of Ocean Development, and the prestigious DN Warrior Medal of the Indian National Science Academy. She is fellow of Indian National Science Academy and West Bengal Academy of Science and Technology. She is also a fellow of the Indian Mountaineering Foundation. Professor Sengupta is also a writer. She has written regularly in Bengali Desh. She has written in Desh. She has got a number of books to her credit. So I welcome her and request her to give her oration.
Thank you, Chandrima. I'm very happy to come here and share my experiences with you, and more happy that the chairperson is Chandrima. I am really proud of her, that she will be the first woman president of Indian National Science Academy from 2020. And I wish her all the success.
Thank you.
And I think it will be better that I will start my story with the slides, because it's easier for me, easier for you also. You will be less bored to listen to my dry lecture, then it will be added some color with my slides. So, I have. Yeah, I'll stand there.
Okay, you can go there.
Okay. I will do this next slide.
Next slide. Yeah.
আর এন্টার এন্টার করলে হবে
ওকে
এন্টার
নেই
এটা ওকে ওকে দ্য Can you see it properly? Okay, the title of my lecture is Chasing Dreams and Breaking Barriers, because I am one of those fortunate person whose not all dreams but most of my dreams really became reality. And I think I will start with next slides with a quotation, and it really, really I believe in that if you dream and work hard to achieve the dream, you just can achieve a lot in your life. Now, just to start with geology also doesn't have the pedigree of physics, chemistry, or even biological sciences, but human being has the knowledge of geology from the prehistoric times. Even in those times, thousands of years ago, they know how to extract ores, how to extract metals from the ores, as we see in different ages, like Iron Ages, Chalco Ages, that they used and made weapons, utensils, coins from these metals. But geology did not have the chance to become a separate, different subject till the end of 18th century or beginning of 19th century. From beginning of 19th century, study of geology became a special entity, and it was taught in different universities in Europe. I think lights should be off, no? Yeah. Is it possible to switch off those lights? Oh. And you will be surprised to know that Geological Survey of India is one of the oldest geological survey in the world. So far I know it is the second oldest, because the oldest is British Geological Survey of India. And they, when they colonized India to extract metals, coals and different purpose, so they established this Geological Survey of India, and it was established in 1851. I think USGSIS was established in 1879, later than our Geological Survey of India. And in India, the first geology department was established in Presidency College in as early as 1892. And the geology department of Jadavpur University, my alma mater, was established in 1956. But it was always a male domain. Very few women geologists were allowed or studied, women studied geology, because geology involves rigorous fieldwork, and the fieldwork is always a problem in those days for the women. So very few women came to study geology, whereas in physics and chemistry and biology, which is laboratory-based science, we know that women studied those subjects and got really good awards. We all know about Marie Curie and others. But geology was a male domain for long. In India, only in Florence Beskow in USA, she first obtained the PhD degree in 1898, and she was the first woman to be a geologist in any geological survey of any country. 1893. Oh, sorry. Yeah, I must read and say it. It's difficult to remember. In India, the women students only started studying geology in 1956. Now, I am a structural geologist, so I will introduce to structural geology a little bit before I start my talk. You know, to a structural geologist, rock is not a rock. It has several designs in it. You can see in the top of the slides that it has designs, and that tells us the story. And from that story, I can deduce that how many times it has been deformed, what was the situation of the stress, and how what strain it suffered, why whether it has been rotated or just deformed. So for us, a piece of rock gives us all the history of that area. And not only in the field, we studied the rocks under microscope. The lower slide shows microscopic deformed granite. In addition, my research also involved geodynamic modeling. What is geodynamic modeling? We try, because the geological structures takes long, millions of years to form, and to have an idea of the situation of the stress and strain and how the deformation continued, we simulate those situations in the laboratory. These are much simpler models, but it gives an idea about how the structures are formed and how they are deformed. So we also simulate them in the laboratory. Now, just few examples of geological structures. These are called folds. It can be a very simple folds, or even in a microscope, we see the similar structure, or it can be a very complicated fold like this one. And this is a treasure trove for a geologist, because this gives a lot of information, much more than a simple one single folded layer. And we can tell you how many times it has been folded, what was the pressure temperature condition during its deformation. So this is a very interesting example of a folded structure. This structure is called budinash. Actually, budin means sausages. It looks like sausages. And these are typical of an extensional features. Fold is a compressional feature. This is an extensional feature. And these are shear zone. Shear zone is very important for any geologist, because that contains a lot of metals and important metals like gold, pyrite means ore of copper, zinc. So shear zone again is a very important feature. These are other structures. I will not go into details of this. And it's a microscopic structure. A very small specimen like this can give you again the whole story of the region. Now I come back to my story. My foundation is my family. My parents were just typical middle-class Bengali family. My father was a brilliant student of physics. He joined Meteorological Survey of India, Meteorological Department. He worked as a meteorologist. My mother was a graduate and a homemaker. But both of them are very progressive in their thinking. And we were three sisters. And my father told us from the very beginning that you can study anything, but I will be happy if you choose science. And so we were almost new from the school days. I loved science also, that we will be scientists. Which scientist? I have no idea. But maybe I just thought I will study physics. But when I, after high secondary, when I applied for physics in Presidency College and Jadavpur University, these are the two institution I wanted to study. In Presidency College, I didn't get a chance in the first list of physics, but in Jadavpur University, I did. So I went for the interview and almost enrolled in physics, but a professor, I think he was a professor of geology. Incidentally, his son is also a geologist and he's present here. Professor Deb, he was the head of the Department of Geology those days. He told me, he asked me a question about why do you want to study physics? I said, I like my father is a physicist, I like to study physics. But he said, okay, next to your study, what do you like best? So I said, I like to travel. So he said, then why are you choosing physics? You should study geology. Because in physics, your life will be restricted in the laboratory. And as a geologist, you will be able to travel a lot. Even as a career, you will be traveling whole your life. So it appealed to me so much, I just stroke off physics and wrote geology. My father was not very happy about it, but I told him that, okay, let me try just for a year. If I don't like geology, I'll come back to physics. But fortunately, I really loved geology, and till now, I think I did the right thing to do, to choose geology. Along with my study, undergraduate study, I also took up mountaineering. My father was posted in Nepal for a few years, for 5 years, and we spent our childhood in Nepal. And in 1953, when Tenzing and Hillary conquered, reached to the summit, I was there. I saw them with my own eyes, Tenzing and Hillary, the hero, and was very impressed. Then later on, during my high secondary and college, rock climbing course was arranged for the first time in Calcutta, in Bengal, and I convinced my parents that I want to join it. And to my father, it was always his motto was, you can do anything as long as it doesn't affect your study. And my mother always encouraged anything extracurricular, whether it's dancing or singing, or even those days she even supported me to go to mountaineering. So I took up rock climbing course first and then mountaineering. I got a scholarship in that rock climbing course to do mountaineering in the Himalayan Mountaineering Institute in Darjeeling. And there my dream came true. I took training under Tenzing. Here is a picture with Tenzing. And I did my basic training, and then next year I took my advanced training, and then I joined even two expeditions. The first one was the first ladies' expedition from India, and the second one is in 1970. We climbed a virgin peak. I was one of the summiters of three summiters. Unfortunately, on our return, I was a deputy leader, and in the center is the leader, Shujaa Guho, and on the other side is Kamala Shaha. On our return, we had an accident, and Shujaa Guho and Kamala Shaha were killed in that accident. It was a traumatic time for me. We could find the body of Shujaadi, and being a deputy leader, I had to take charge and cremated her with the help of Indian Army there in Kilong. But we couldn't find body of Kamala Shaha. Anyway, because of mountaineering, I enjoyed field work very much. This is a picture from my field work, and I practiced chimney climbing now and then whenever I found chances. And I will come to it later. So after PhD, I went to England to carry out my postdoctoral research in the Royal School of Mines, Imperial College. And that was a really, really my entering to the real world, outside world. I met so many people and I worked with two illustrious persons there. Professor Janet Watson and John Ramsey, they are actually the top structural geologists even now. But not only that, I could meet so many eminent people there, because London being Imperial College, being in the central part of the world, so many people from the all over the world visited, gave lecture, and I had the chance to interact with them. So that's 3 years of my life was very important and did help to build my foundation. Then after that, I went to Uppsala University and had the chance with to work with Professor Rambaugh. He was again a very doyen of his subject, and I did carry out field work in different parts of Scandinavian Caledonians. I visited again the laboratory later in 96 and 97 for 1 year. Now these are my mentors. The first one is Shubhir Ghosh, who was my PhD supervisor as well as senior colleague when I joined back to Jadavpur University. Jadet Watson was my mentor in my postdoctoral days, and she was one of the pioneering women geologists, and she is the first woman president of Geological Society of London. A very, very, very illustrious person, a very soft-spoken, with a great depth of knowledge, and I really admire her and wanted to be like her in those days. Then John Ramsey was also in Imperial College. She was not my mentor, but somehow he always took a liking in me and arranged for me to join his field trip. Not only then, but later also. And from him, I have also learned a lot. Then in Sweden, I had Hans Rambaugh as my mentor. And not only, he was another person who really took care to teach me not only field geology, but laboratory experiments in his lab. Now on my return, I joined again Geological Survey of India, and then after three, I felt very restricted after 5 years abroad, because after all, in a government organization, you cannot choose your topic of research or you cannot do what you like. So I joined Jadavpur University as a lecturer in 1982. And I found my previous supervisor as my senior colleague, and this is my first group of research student. This is our first group of research student, and I am happy to know to let you know that all of them are stars in their own right now. On the extreme left is Nibir Mondal, who is a Bhatnagar awardee now and a faculty of Jadavpur University. Then second from right is Anupam Chatterjee. He is a professor of Delhi. Other two works as director of Geological Survey of India. So our lab becomes very famous gradually and produced a number of very, very bright students who are really doing well in their life. And my first trip, field trip with the boys in 1982, as you can notice that there is no woman there. For first 15 years of my life, there will be hardly any woman in the class. Just one or two, and most of the year, none. But things changed after 10, 15 years. When I retired, at least 30% of the classes were girl students. And this is, again, another picture with my students. Two of them are, so 50% is girl, and all of them are very doing well in their life. One of them is a lecturer, assistant professor in Presidency One University. One of them is in the Atomic Energy Division, and One of them is doing postdoctoral research in German, Bochum, Germany, and one is a senior geologist in Geological Survey of India. So I'm very proud of my students. I think for a teacher, it's the greatest reward when you see your students, especially women students, shine like stars. And here, just a small graph, you can notice that first, it was the decade, first, second, third, fourth, up to fourth decade, per 10 years, there are only 5, 6, 7 students. The percentage, women students, percentage of women students are 1.8, 4.3, 4.3, 3.8. But from 96 onwards, I can see some jump in the women students in the class, and it's nearly 30% each year. So that's a real great improvement of percentage of women students in our profession. Now, why women hesitate to take up geology? Because field work, as I said, a rigorous field work is a part of our profession. And for field work, you need to say remote areas, and accommodation is a real problem in most of the areas. In our time, it's terrible. We stayed in dharmashalas, sometimes hut meant. When I did my PhD study, I actually stayed in huts. Now the situation is far better. They stay in guest houses or hotels. Everywhere you can find decent accommodation. Another thing is safety in the field. That was far better in our time. I did my PhD study for 3 consecutive years, 1 month each, 2 months per year, alone, with sometimes with a young Santali boy, sometimes whoever I can get as a guide cum coolie. And I traveled through jungles, through remote places. Those days, there was no connection. The roads are terrible, communication was nil, and I didn't have any money to hire jeeps or anything, so I had to walk. So at the beginning of the day, you go with your energy, with map, compass, haversack, hammer, everything, and end of the day, you really trudged along with a heavy rucksack with your hammer, and then it gets dark and you again walk to come back to the... But I never felt unsafe. But these days, everything is fine. They go by car, they go by jeep, they go by auto. Communication is fine, roads are fine, but safety is a problem. I wouldn't dare to send a single girl, as I did my fieldwork alone, I wouldn't dare to send a single girl in remote area alone to do field work. So that is a really problem. And of course, when you take up a profession as a geologist, you have to balance family and children, especially for young mothers to leave the children home and do field work is quite a problem. I will share some of my field experiences. I did field work in Sengupta. On pebble deformation, some of the beautiful pictures of pebbles. I won't explain and bore you with the details, but you see the beauty of some structures here. As I said, there was some problem working in Sengupta those days. And I remember I faced rogue elephants, some very often poisonous snakes, because in no geologist you can find who never met snakes in their field. Snakes are almost part of our job, partner in our area. I remember just one incident. There are so many, I won't go into details, but one incident, we were doing field work with 2 of my research students in near Ramgiri gold mines. In a area, the area called Naga Samudram. So you can, the people there, warned us that you better be careful about snakes, the area is full of snakes. So we were hammering all our rocks, stamping our feet all the time so that the snakes hide themselves. And then after lunchtime, we sat in a clean area. There was no trees, it was a bare ridge and clean area to have lunch. And then it was very hot, and I have a felt covered water bottle next to me. And suddenly I found, when I was going to take the water bottle, there is a snake coiling around my water bottle. And it has yellow and black stripes on your body. And I was so surprised, of course scared, but fortunately I didn't move much. I just said, snake. And then others didn't believe me. But that little movement made the snake to uncoil and leave the place. So then they saw the snakes and they jumped out. And I was really fortunate that I didn't jump out. Then it may have bitten me. But that is part of our fieldwork life. A little bit more. Then we did fieldwork in Kolar. Again, Fulat. I did, last 15 years I've been doing fieldwork in Rajasthan in different parts, mostly in Fulat, Rajasthan, near Jodhpur. There's some of the illustrious geologists with me, Professor Naha, Shubhit Ghosh, and Professor A.B. Roy in the field of Rajasthan. Then, during my postdoctoral day, I did fieldwork in Scotland, in glacial region. That was, again, my another new experiences in being alone, doing fieldwork alone in a foreign country. But I didn't have much problem because there are lots of youth hostels in England. I stayed one of the youth hostels. Only thing, I had to walk a lot because there was no conveyance. But otherwise, it was a smooth field trip. Then, during my field work in Scandinavian Caledonites, when I was in Uppsala, I had a different kind of experiences. For the project, I was doing field work in Stankir, which is close to Arctic Circle. It was a very small village. They have never seen Indian people. To them, to have an Indian girl moving around with a hammer is something very, very new. Plus, there was the problem of language. My professor, Hans Ramberg, he arranged for me to camp in a farmland of a farmer. He was an old man living alone, but he allowed me to pitch my tent in his land. And that time I bought a small sub to do field work because we had to cover a lot of area. And I was driving that sub in that hilly region. I was not a very good driver, almost a novice driver. But I managed somehow because there is hardly any other car. Then one day, during a negotiation, I hit my car against a rock and the bonnet of the car got stuck in the tire and it won't move. And it was high up in the mountain. There was none around. I was sitting. I didn't know what to do. I was just waiting for someone to come and help me. Then fortunately, one farmer was passing by. He was so surprised to see me, say an Indian girl stuck there with a car and with rocks in her rucksack, that it took some time for him to realize the situation. Plus, there was barrier of languages. But he was very kind, took me to his home in his car, gave me a sherry, because I was shaking almost in fear and cold and everything, and then food, and then finally reached me to my own tent. And then next day, he hammered my car because it was not a big problem. It just got the bonnet just got stuck in the tire. He hammered it and drove it back and returned the car to me. And it was like that. They were so helpful. I mean, it was a strange country. I didn't know their language, but the life was so difficult for me, a single girl doing field work in a remote area in a country. But I really enjoyed it. It was exciting, not only exciting, and it taught me that people are same everywhere. They are basically good. They are basically helpful. This is another story. For 3 months, I did field work with Swedish Geological Survey as summer geologist. And I did work. We went to a place called Oreskutan, have our base camp there. From there, we work in a group of 10 geologists, one leader, and I was the only female and only foreigner. The rest are all from Sweden. And we have to cover quite a large area, and we were dropped in helicopter to remote places, two in groups, in each group, in five groups, and we had to finish the area. And that was first time I rode a helicopter and first time I walked in such a remote mountainous area. And it was fortunately Swedish forest or Swedish mountains doesn't have much poisonous snakes or anything. No rogue elephants also. It has beautiful reindeers, and the cold and the wind is a problem. And sometimes the bog, they call bog, it looks like a green field, grass field, but actually it's full of mud. So once by mistake, I tried to do shortcut through a bog and got almost submerged in that bog. But otherwise, it was a very, very new experience, exciting experience. And I'm fortunate to have all these varieties of experiences. In fact, these prepared me for my next Antarctic expedition. In those days, we used to dream in those remote corner, sitting in a tent, that someday it will be so exciting if we can go to Greenland or Antarctica. I never thought that dream will ever become true, but it has. Then in later life, I had, as I told you, Professor Ramsey was very kind to always invite me to join his field trip and arrange for my finance. I did very rigorous field work in Alps with his group. This is the group in front of Mont Blanc. Then in Pyrenees, I was invited to be a mentor to teach a group of students, in an international group of students, to do field work. These are some pictures of those places of Cap de Creu in Spain. Then I was fortunate to do field work in central China in Hubei province. And again, I was the only woman in the team. The other woman is our interpreter. The Chinese woman standing next to me was our interpreter. It was also a very, very enriching experience because all the members of the team were very eminent structural geologists from different parts of the world. Now, my ultimate field experience is in Antarctica. Now, Antarctica is another male bastion. There was hardly any woman scientist in Antarctica before 1956. Although women went there as a wife and spent time over there, but women scientists were not allowed. They used to say that there is no beauty parlor in Antarctica. What woman can do here? Or sometimes in British Antarctic Survey, they said that if I take woman, I have to arrange each woman scientist for each main scientist. So we just can't allow one or two women to go there, because then there will be fight among men, as if they are going to there to court. Anyway, but women did break the ice wall, and Maria Klenova was the first marine geologist to work in Antarctica in 1956. Then next, in 1969, four women from USA and three women from New Zealand visited South Pole for the first time. And amongst the American team, there were two geologists, the leader and another member. Now, when I returned to India in 81, India took their first expedition to Antarctica. Dr. Syed Zahoor Kasim was the team leader, and I was very excited. In 82, when I joined Jadavpur University, I immediately wrote to Department of Ocean Development and sort of volunteered to join the expedition. But I got the answer that they are not considering any woman scientist. However, in 1983, I just got a telegram that come for an interview. And then I went for the interview. I got selected, then got the medically fit certificate and was sent to Kargil in Machi Glacier for the training, took the training, and they didn't know I already am advanced trained in mountaineering. But anyway, I got selected and got the chance to go to Antarctica. And Dr. Aditi Pant, who is the marine biologist, okay, she was the other woman scientist to go with the third expedition. Now, Antarctica for any scientist is a dream come true, because it has special significance. It is the only polar continent. Arctic is a sea, as you know. For glaciologically, the glaciers, the ice sheet there contains loads of information. For biologically, there are endemic fauna and flora. Geologically, of course, it is the key piece of Gondwana land. For an upper atmospheric scientist, study of aurora and ozone hole is there. Meteorologically, it affects the whole weather of the world. And of course, it's the environmentally, it's the benchmark of the world. So when we go to Antarctica, I will just describe a little bit of the journey. You pass through a frozen sea, and Antarctica is surrounded by pack ice. That is the part of the ice, part of the sea which gets frozen in winter and then gets broken in the next summer and gets frozen again. So this part of the frozen, broken ice is called pack ice. And it gets thicker and thicker as you go south. And gradually, you enter a clean area of blue sea, which is called Polynia, and freshly broken sea ice, like this one. We went by ship and returned by ship. It took about a month to reach there, a month to come back, and we stayed there for 2 months. And on the way, you see icebergs, beautiful icebergs with layers, visible layers of annual ablation and freezing. Then you finally reach the continent. It does look like ice cream kind of continent, but it is a very, very hard ice. It's crystalline ice. It's almost as hard as a rock. It can cut the ship in like a blade cuts the paper. But the ice shelf is not a plain ice field. It has sastrugis, which is similar to the sand dunes in a desert. And of course, the animals are really interesting. In the land or in the main continent of Antarctica doesn't have any vegetation, so it doesn't support any life. But the water, the sea surrounding the Antarctic, this has an annual freezing and defreezing effect that makes the water rich in minerals, and it supports rich flora, and then that supports rich fauna. That the basis of these animals in Antarctica are krills. It's a crustacean like our shrimp, and it, depending on it, all the whales, it's the main food for penguins, seals, and whales. So all there are, we saw mainly two variety of penguins. These are Adélie penguins, and it's a smaller version, but very curious. And emperor penguins is a bigger version, but they are really emperor-like and slow in their movement, and they really can weigh as much as a human being, 45 to 50 kg. This is our ship. Actually, it was the second expedition with Thuleland. And another common animal in Antarctica are the seals. There are four varieties of seals, and you see in summer all the seals basking in the sun on the ice field. And they couldn't much care about human being. And since their body is so heavy, they can't move on the ice, they can't move fast. In the water, they move like really quick, and that's why the outside temperature is much lower. In winter, it can be minus 50 degrees Celsius, whereas inside water, it's never be less than minus 1.8. So they live mostly in the sea and made holes in the ice. When we went there for the first time, the army engineers built Dakshin Gangotri, the permanent research station. And the building was opened in 1984. So I was present there during the opening ceremony. When I went there for the second time in ninth expedition, that same research station is submerged in ice, as you can see in the lower slide. And in 1990, it was declared closed, and I was also present during that closing ceremony. During 83-84, the third expedition, we stayed in tents because the Shimakar Hills, our main area of work, there was nothing. So it was another experience to live in tents in Antarctica, because you know Antarctica is called land of blizzards. So there will be, most of the time there will be blizzards. The tents are almost blown away. You have to get up in the cold to fix your tents. And then there is daylight 24 hours. So you never know which, unless you watch your watch, you never know which time of the day it is. So in the night when you sleep, you get up at 1 o'clock, you watch, oh no, okay, we can go back to sleep. Get up at 4 o'clock, oh no, we can go back to sleep. So it's the same. So we had a really tough life. We had to prepare our food, then go to field. And since it's daylight, we used to walk till late, till even 10 o'clock. And it was very strenuous, but very, very exciting. When I went there for the second time, the Dakshin Gangotri was abandoned, but a new station came up in Shimakar Hills, which is called Maitri Station. And I had the fortune to stay in the station and carry out field work in the Shimakar Hills. So this is our group of three geologists in 1983-84, and when two German geologists visited my camp, our camp, and I went there with the 9th expedition. Then during the 15th, 16th and 17th expedition, my students worked there. I got a project when two of my students worked there. One of them got PhD. This is the general view of Schumacher Hills. And you can see the beauty of this area. And another thing is important for the geologist to work there, that although 98% is covered by thick ice, sometimes the ice can be 3 kilometers to 4 kilometers thick, but the 2% which is exposed is very, very fresh and a pleasure for a geologist to work on these fresh rocks. So during third expedition, we did prepare the lithological and structural map of the area, which has, as Chandrima mentioned, become the fundamental basis of the further walk over there. And I repeated the again as a geologist in with the ninth expedition. But after reaching there in 1989, we had an accident there when four members of our team died in that accident by carbon monoxide poisoning, and three of them were geologists. So I had a real traumatic time because they were my we were supposed to work together, and they're gone. Our leader was a geologist, but he had to do all this very unfortunate job to send the dead bodies back home and deal with the families and all that. So he has to stay in the ship and deal with all this job. And I was alone. And he warned me that you cannot do carry on work alone. You have to take some member with you, then you only carry on work. But each and every member has their own job to do. I couldn't get anyone to come with me and spend the whole day with me with my field work. So without telling him, I just carried on my work on my own. It was very difficult. It was traumatic. All the time I had to really be very careful that I shouldn't be in an accident, because sometimes there will be blizzards, sometimes there will be steep rocks, but somehow I could alone finish all my job and did a satisfactory job in this expedition. I would not go into the details of these rocks. These rocks are very similar to the rocks we found in South India, very old rocks from Archean to Proterozoic age. And these are some examples of these rocks. They are several generations of deformation and metamorphism and intrusion of dikes. And I won't again go into details of that. Some of them are rare rocks found in Antarctica, and they can they tells you story about the rocks formed under great depth. Now I have come to my end of my story, and this is a mantra I believe in. And before I end, I want to tell you one more thing, that I come from a land which is a land of Durga. We worship Durga. And when I was a child, I used to believe Durga lives in Kailash. But now I know Durga lives in us, in all women. Whether she's a scientist, she's a politician, she's an artist, she's a homemaker, or a domestic worker, or a manual laborer in the field, all of us are version of Durga. And we we really fight against all adversities in our life and be a winner. But unfortunately, all of them cannot be winner. There are still many Durgas, they could not defeat their demons. And I hope in our country, each and every Durga wins and they finally become a winner. Thank you very much.
Dr. Sengupta for giving a very interesting insight into her life and work. And I'm sorry, I forgot to introduce myself. I am a biologist, actually not a geologist. I'm Professor Eminence at the National Institute of Immunology. So would you answer some questions from the audience?
Yeah, sure.
Yes, anyone has questions, I will, yeah.
What was the year? I mean, 83, 84, that period. But only thing that she was a marine geologist. She stayed in the ship.
Oceanography.
So she stayed in the ship, whereas I stayed in the tent in the inside the continent.
Her father and her family also.
I see.
I'm an old friend of mine.
Yeah.
Old friend of mine.
I see.
Anyone else? I was thinking, you didn't tell us the stories about these stones. I mean, they have these beautiful designs.
Yes.
And there must be a lot of chemical stories, physical stories inside.
Yes.
So.
Yes, maybe some other time I will go into those stories only. Because that will take another hour.
So in 1983, when you went, that was a time when it was not very common for women to, you know, go into these fields, as you alluded to.
Yes.
But you said your parents were very supportive. What about your other relatives and all there?
Oh, at the beginning, they used to criticize my father and mother because they used to say, I still remember that you give too much independence to your daughters. You never said anything. What is this climbing mountains and all these things? And my father said that after all, they will have to cook and get married. So my father used to tell them, never. If they want to cook, if they want to get married, fine, let them do. But I will never let them, I will always let them choose their own life and do whatever they please like. So my father was like a rock. My mother was always supported us because she was also adventurous in her heart. And somehow she never stopped me doing this kind of adventures. She may be nervous. She will always say, don't be careful. You shouldn't do any hectic things. But she will never stop us. So I'm very fortunate in my life to have that kind of parents.
So I brought this up because things have changed now. I think it is changing more. And so let's hope. Any other questions? Yes.
Because stones form in the gallbladder, and I've seen them, colorful like the ones that you've shown. How do they get formed in the gallbladder?
I have seen, because I have seen my own stone. But I never had the heart to do thin section and find out. I suppose it will be calcareous. I think a biologist can...
in our body, we have these strange chemical salts, uric acids and phosphates.
Yes, yeah. They look like agates. Yeah, right.
Agates.
Yes.
So they're gallbladder, they're in the kidneys, so stones can form in many places. Yes. 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 So, yes, please.
So, what is the basic purpose of the field work? And could you discover something really new which can add to the scientific world of geology while going for field work, like some petro mines and kind of things?
Oh yes, basic purpose is always to study the rocks. I mean, if you don't know the basics, you can't go to the applied part. To the best, unless you prepare the basic map of geology, you know what kind of rocks are available where, and then you only know that. What can you expect to get it from there? Because suppose oil occurs in a different kind of rock, coals occur in a different kind of rock, minerals occur in a different kind of rock. So basic purpose of fieldwork is always do the find out what rocks where occur where, how, and what kind of pressure temperature they have suffered. Then you only know that what you can do with it. Actually, I wouldn't say discover something. I'm basically a structural geologist, and structure means like a building, you need to know the structure. So like earth crust, you need to know that what kind of structures. So our aim is to study the deformation, how many times it has been deformed, what was the stress strain condition during the deformation, what was the pressure temperature condition during deformation, so and how many times it has deformed in what way. So this tells us from the field only. So we have to do field. If we need to do some experiments, we do it in the laboratory, as I said, simulating this conditions, situation, but those models are very simpler models. We can't really simulate the complicated natural structures, but some part we can simulate and then have build an idea, build a theory about it.
Even though if it doesn't have an application, you know, it is a sheer excitement of knowing how the earth formed.
Yeah, and sometimes so, yeah. It's not the immediate application.
Yes.
Somebody maybe after 50 years can use that data to for applied purpose.
Yes, you wanted to say something?
I wanted to give a couple of suggestions. I wanted to organize a talk by Aditi at Hyderabad. I am born in Hyderabad. Every time she went on post Pune, I met her in Pune in 2013. I request you do come to Hyderabad. I will invite Aditi also and a madam. That's one point. See, I know many of my uncle was the vice chancellor of Usmani University, Suri Bhagavantam. His son was Geological Survey of Hyderabad, President Balkrishna. You must be knowing. You know?
No.
Geo physical laboratories in.
I know the lab, but I don't know personally.
Then you know. Leela Nandam, he was geologist.
Yeah, I know.
He's my cousin.
Oh, I see. I know him very well.
Yes. He retired recently. He's about 85, older than me. Yeah. And I know a number of geologists. And I belong to, I'm born in Hyderabad. Vice Chancellor, he was at the Defense Advisor to Defense, Ministry of Defense, in the 1960s. Surya Bhagavantham was Scientific Advisor, Defense Minister.
Okay.
He was the CSIR chairman and all that. No, just suggestion, and it is my pleasure to invite you and Madam and Aditi to Hyderabad at my cost, and a good number associated with number of organizations. I would like to arrange this in Hyderabad in about 4 to 5 months.
Thank you.
Hyderabad is very, very.
Yeah, sure. Thank you very much.
Hyderabad is not cold. It's just pleasant.
No, I've been to Hyderabad and I like it. I like the city very much.
Yes, you have a question. Yes, yes, sir, please.
Well, can you briefly describe the Antarctic Circle?
Antarctic Circle.
Basic features, its physical features and all that. Briefly, Antarctic Circle.
Arctic and Antarctic.
Arctic.
Oh, it's an imaginary line at 66.5 degree latitude. And beyond this line, or beyond this line in Arctic, or beyond this line in Antarctic, the sun will stay 24 hours. 24 hours for
it's 24-hour day.
A day, yes, yes. So as you go more north or more south. Sun stays on the sky more and more, and we in Antarctica, our Dakshin Gangotri was situated in 71 degrees south. So we saw this 24-hour sun for about 1.5 months. So when we reached there, we used to, and in the polar region, you will never see sun on top of your head. It encircles over the horizon. And towards the end of January, the sun starts touching the horizon and then gets up within minutes again. So that is the end of a day and beginning of a morning of next day. So it was really interesting. End of the, in January, we used to watch, wake up till 12 o'clock to till late to see that phenomena, that sun is setting down and just the next morning for a few minutes after it's going up again. And then at as time progresses, the daytime also, nighttime also increases. And then again it will be equinox in March, equal day and
You see that in Kanyakumari also.
Yes.
In Bombay it's not dark at 11 o'clock in the evening. Bombay is not dark at 11 o'clock in the evening, in summer. After 11 o'clock it's summer in Bombay.
In Kud-
it gets dark.
In Kud- yes. She wants to ask a question. Yes.
Hi, Sudipta. You mentioned that when you were going for the Antarctic expedition, women were not allowed that time before that, right? I wanted to know how liberal are things for women right now for Antarctic expeditions?
I think it's a different scenario now, different scenario. Because since we have, since 83, there are almost every year women are going to Antarctica, with India, I think. And then I heard that same year, in 83, there was an article in BBC. From that I have learned that from Germany, women wanted to go. Like I wanted to go, Aditi wanted to go. But they were not allowed. Because of the same reason, the leader of the expedition and the others member were asked that, will you take two or three women? And they said no. And then finally that lady, her name is Maria Pupulstek or something, she arranged a lot of women and she applied, she wrote to a lot of women scientists, do you want to go to Antarctica? And then hundreds of them said yes, and they all wrote to the their Antarctic division, and they had, even then, they were not allowed, they didn't want to mix the male and woman group together, but they arranged one expedition mainly only for women in, I think, 1986. She was the leader of an all-woman expedition to Antarctica. And situation is now, you will see 40% at places, there are 40-30% women working. They are doing important job in U.S., NSF Foundation, they are doing drilling work in Antarctica, and I saw, I met, I went to one Antarctic conference, and most of the presenter was women. It's
yes,
totally different
please.
Picture now.
Since yours were the time when technological development was not so much. And the lecture says focuses on women in science and technology. And today the technology has developed a lot. So I would like to know how this has changed the field work and exploration job for a geologist, these technological advancements.
Oh, for us, it's a lot. I mean, besides this logistic supports, you know, we never had GPS there. We had to find our location with the geographical features. It was a terrible, I mean, we used to spend so much time to have an exact location, just where we are standing. And it was often found that one geologist would say that I have found, say, support, I have found gold in that location. But next one will not find that. That kind of situation used to happen. But now with the handheld GPS, you know exact what latitude, longitude you are standing, even with a smartphone. My students go there with a smartphone and locate themselves. It's tremendous help these days. And another thing I would like to mention, you know, after my Antarctic expedition, I wrote a book in Bengali on my expedition. It's a popular book, popular science book. And it was serialized in a magazine, Bengali magazine called Desh. And then it was published as a book. And then I got tremendous response from the women. And especially, I think, writing in regional language is very important, because girls from villages wrote to me that we want to be like you, we want to also go Antarctica. And at the interview, when I was taking the interview for new students to come in the department, they used to say, I have chosen geology because after reading your books. And one of that students, Nilanjana Sharkar, she just visited me last month with a box of sweet. And she said that, Madam, when I was in class 8, I read your book and I promised I will go to Antarctica like you. So I came and studied geology, and now she is working in the Center for Earth Sciences in Trivandrum. And this year I am selected to go to Antarctica. And she is going to Antarctica this year. So her dream also came true.
The Nature Book Trust will publish all these languages also. Nature Book Trust is the organization that published books in not only Hindi, English, but also in languages.
Well, I would like to thank all of you. We have to call it a day. And I would like to thank Sudipta again for giving us such an insight into her life and work.
Thank you very much for giving this scope. Thank you, Chandrima. It was nice.